Can't tell what magic spells we'll be doing for us. And I'm giving up my love to this world, only to be told. I can't see, I can't breathe, no, not where we'll be. And now there's gonna change. She used to be an actress.
Did she ever do anything I would have saw?
I think her biggest deal was she starred in a pilot.
What's a pilot?
Well, you know, the shows on TV.
I don't watch TV.
Yes, but you're aware that there's an intervention called television, and on that invention they show shows?
Yeah.
Well, the way they pick the shows on TV is they make one show, and that show's called a pilot. Then they show that one show to the people who pick the shows, and on the strength of that one show, they decide if they want to make more shows. Some get accepted and become TV programs, and some don't, and become nothing. She starred in one of the ones that became nothing.
Just so you know, for the rest of this episode, don't look to him for approval. Look to me for approval.
Just like I do.
And also, he read that 10 times better than I ever have on one take.
You made your dad look like he was in first grade. Good job.
Hey, welcome to Couch Pilots. All of you are my friends. It's the show that dares to fly into the unknown territory of awful television pilots of the past. My name is Jason, and with me is the original furry. It's Captain Philip Ressisure. Good evening. I love you.
I love you, too. You know what? I'm not going to lie. Are we okay to talk like normal people here?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
She was one of our guests is a lady, and her son is here, and she was cursing in front of him. I think the gates are open.
But I have to get consent first, because a lot of parents are like,
smart. You know, that's good.
You know, don't be fucking cursing in front of my fucking kid.
All right, what were we going
to
say?
I was going to say, you know what? Mm-hmm. I would want to experience that one time. I would think I would try it. I would dress up as like a panda bear, because I look like a panda bear. Mm-hmm. I would dress up as a panda bear and fuck like a monkey or a gorilla. I would try it.
I don't know much about the furry.
That's not a bit. I would try it.
I totally believe you, by the way. I got two things I want to say. One is I don't know what the levels of furry are. I think there is like full-on college mascot outfit. And then there might be like some flaps, you know, like so they can open areas for whatever reason. Doesn't matter why. But I think there's other things where it's like you just maybe have like a mask or something. Like, you know what I mean? There's like different levels of the costumes.
Sure.
Second thing
is... Or like I had a panda penis. Hey, look up panda penis and see if they're big or not. What's the average size of a panda? Look on your cell phone and look up panda penis.
That's good.
Connect to his Wi-Fi and then look at...
Right.
The second thing
my Wi-Fi would be like, hello?
I think it's about 6 years ago, I went to Lover's Playground. It used to be called Swingers World. Mm-hmm. It's in downtown Peoria. Yeah. It's a marital aid shop.
Yeah.
Anyway, I went there with a handful of people, and you're one of them, Blake.
Yes.
And we went there, and I was with a lady, doesn't matter who it was. And we went into this back room. It's like an arcade, which is like liberal use of the word arcade, by the way. And when I came out, you had purchased an item. It was in a bag, an opaque bag. And I said, hey, Blake, I just got done doing whatever I was doing back there. I'm ready to go. What do you have in that bag? And he said, I'm not telling you. And,
right.
I was like, come on. We just took a lap around this place. We've seen every boob and penis item on the market available for people to purchase, silicone and otherwise. What's in your bag? He said, you can't know. I'll never tell.
Right.
And I am thinking, it might be furry related.
It could be. It could be.
Would you like to tell us now? We're in the last season of Couch Pilots. The show is winding down. Would you like to tell everyone?
No.
There are some people who've been listening years ago who've been waiting on bated breath to find out what that was.
Maybe I'll announce it. Maybe I'll announce all my purchases. I'll tell you one thing right now.
There's more than one purchase.
If you look on my Amazon, my mom said, make your own Amazon account. You ain't buying that shit on mine.
Totally ruining her algorithm.
Yeah, her algorithm.
You know, Al Gore's rhythm?
Al Gore's, right, yeah, he invented
that's how you don't get a girl pregnant.
The Al Gore rhythm method?
Speaking of pregnant, I was 7 months pregnant with the group of friends in there.
Oh, were you?
7 months pregnant.
So you've been in there.
You've been in there.
I told him.
I asked him before the show, you ever been in a swingers where he said, all I could see was the floor.
Nice.
Anyway, final season of the show, and we said, what do we do in the last season? It said we get all of our favorite people on the show. And a lot of times you and I are liars, but not when it comes to that.
No.
That's a true statement. Our favorite people.
Yeah. I mean, there was a perfect joke, and we were like, well, none were available tonight. But that was not right. That would just be a bit.
That would be a bit. No, the truth is, the last season...
There's no way that, like, seven people said no, they couldn't do it tonight. Definitely, we wanted to have you guys.
Every episode, two people per episode, and we did our best to match them perfectly. We're actually bending over backwards in some cases to get a certain people and, like, locations for recording. There's people that we want, and we're going to get them. And you guys are on that list. And I know Scott is a good get. He's an easy get. He will always say yes, and we love him for that.
He will always say yes if his wife lets him come over.
His wife is a tough get.
She is.
She's
tough.
So let's.
So we got his girlfriend instead.
Why don't you introduce him, man? You guys go way.
We'll do it like we have been. I go to my right. You go to the left.
Okay. Yeah. Let's go ahead.
Or actually, you'd go to your right. I go to my right.
Okay. So we're gonna introduce you both, but we're gonna do it at the same time. Does that work for you guys?
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
On three.
Two, one.
All right. Everybody
guys,
knows
I'm
my
so
our next guest.
Yes.
He was
on
It Burns My IP as our special security guard.
Impossible to think.
You remember him
but
from
she's the
Broken
wife of
Funny
one of our
Bone.
Most favorite guests.
You remember him from his great karaoke podcast, Karaoke Biggie. Let's welcome to the show, Karaoke Biggie's Biggie.
Thank you so much.
Oh, boy. Chaos. Thanks for having us.
Yes, thanks for having us.
It's a new bit we've been working on. It's going great.
Yeah, it sounds awesome.
We said, what's a new bit we could start about 3 weeks from being done?
Yeah, that way you can guarantee that the listeners are...
Oh, yeah, that's how we lock them in.
Ooh, I love this.
That's because what they do is they listen to it and they try to like single out, and then they'll rewind it, so it sounds it's like an extra download.
You guys did it strategically, so
yeah.
For one take, they can turn down the left channel...
And oh, shit, I could have done that.
Well, let me ask you this. Scott's breaking this down like, hey, how does this work? The numbers. Have we ever really broken down on the show with Scott here how his whole pyramid scheme vape code worked when you're doing Karaoke Biggie? We've never really broken that down?
No. Well,
we
Kevin seemed to think that it was that Honey app is... why it works so
okay,
well.
Okay, so you used to do a show that I created. I mean, I exude creativity.
You piss and, excellence.
Yeah. Karaoke Biggie,
mm-hmm.
The show that you did like 200 episodes of mm-hmm. it.
Then your wife said to stop.
Early on, you had a code for vaping,
yeah.
a vape code for people could say like 20%.
Yeah.
Was it like something bomb? Was that it was?
Hempbombs.com.
That's what it was? Mm-hmm. And you...
still around.
I'm not going to say the amount, because I honestly don't even know the specific amount, but you made a nice chunk of change doing that, right?
A little bit.
You did all right.
I love Christy's ring. Looks great.
Her implants look great, too.
They could knock a mic over.
Did you really need three breasts? I think that's too much.
A special request from Big E. He's like, in case two of them are mad, I've still got one.
Every guy has two, I want to get three.
What was the plan in going into taking this code for hemp bombs? And what was the plan in making this work for you? Because out of everyone that I know, no joke, Scott has made more money podcasting and done maybe the least in the long run. which seriously...
No plan. It
makes him
happened.
The smartest podcaster I know. And it's not a joke. Scott is the smartest pod... Blake's been doing it 15 years. Scott's better at making money at it than you are.
It was fleeting. It was like 1 year.
Yeah.
If that. 1 year. So fleeting.
And it was 1 year, and then all of a sudden it just... Whoosh,
so
it was gone.
You had a code that was specific for your show.
Mm-hmm.
And if someone went to this website and bought this product... Welcome mm-hmm. to the show, Chrissy, by the way. You had... they had this code. They'd save money, but then you would get a little taste of that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how did you get it out there? How did so many people use that code? Can you tell us what your process was?
I have no idea. Like I said, Kevin thought it might have showed up on that little thing on your browser called Honey.
Yeah.
That's the only thing he can think of.
The Honey app is like something you can, it's like an attachment for your browser where if you go somewhere to buy something, Honey is supposed to like automatically kick in and say, hey, if you use this code or do this thing, you can save money.
Right. When it was working, I was posting it on Facebook until it got banned from there because of the because
he was making too much money on
because of the CBD thing. And then I've always had it on Instagram. Just I would make, you know, I would post the code. I'd put it on Twitter.
Every episode, because I listened to every episode of Karaoke Biggie, and every episode you'd be like, this is how many Twitter followers I have. Like for a while, that was kind of like a running thing where
we still maintain about 3,500.
But that was Twitter a big followers. Thing of you. Like for a while, you were proud of how many Twitter. But like
it kept going up and up.
I didn't know if that was part of you using that code and being successful with it was going through Twitter. But you were using different social media outlets:
Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. But I don't. It never got much reaction from any of those. So
you truly don't know where that success came from.
No clue.
But do you remember that, Blake? He was super active on social media.
He was killing it. He was doing the legwork.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Then it just, like I said, it was as quick as it came, it went.
Well, I don't want to give an exact number, but it was north of $500,000.
It was.
Oh shit, we weren't supposed to say that in front of you.
And the tax man took over half of it.
Oh no.
Ooh. Wasn't it such a cool promo code now?
No, it wasn't.
I disagree. I think half of something is more than half of nothing, right?
It worked, but yeah.
So, are you okay? You seem very agitated. Are you okay?
Get the microphone in front of Chris.
Yeah, put that in front of you. He's not
talking. Their son is here. Dylan's here.
She pinched her boob. Hold on.
He pinched the third one.
Okay.
You don't have to lean.
There you go.
Oh, okay. Well,
hold on a minute.
Blake's going to get up and readjust the mic.
There we go.
Some people say by 400 episodes.
Microphone up. Okay.
It's not mine.
It's mine.
It's his.
It's all coming with me.
This one is?
Yes.
So it's all coming with me at the end. I get it all.
Okay.
So is that one. And so is that.
Are you okay?
It is. Yeah, I'm fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
You were having fun, but then we pressed record, and now you look like you're having fun now.
You have diarrhea.
Cha cha cha.
I have that.
How long have you and Biggie been married?
27.
I'm asking her questions. Okay, she can speak for herself. She carried a gun around. She can 26 speak.
26 years.
Are you happy with that mic?
26 years.
Now I am.
Are you sure?
26 years. How many years does it feel like?
80.
Sweet.
Or like Kevin's dad says, it's like 26 minutes underwater.
How long have you been married to your wife? 9 years. It hasn't been that long. I'm married. I measure my dog years because my wife's a bitch. So you have been a podcasting wife for a few years now. How has that affected your life?
Not at all. No. I didn't mind that he does it. No. Unless he's coming here and lying, I never cared that he does it.
Well, very rarely did he come and do the show here. I don't know where he would go, but he would very rarely come here.
That's a good thing about podcasting. If you are a horribly jealous and insecure wife like yourself, you could say, no, there's a recording. He's going somewhere to record something. I can check that was recorded. We have physical, we have proof that he was here.
I love you guys, but I never listened to the show.
No,
maybe one or two.
Actually, I think that all podcast wives take an oath not to listen to any of them.
I listened to one and I was like, nope, not anymore.
It's too good. I can't listen to all of them.
Right? Maybe, yeah, sure.
It's been so long since my wife listened to Couch Pilots that we did 4 or 5 bits today that she refused to accept because she thought she's like, no.
And her voice kept getting higher. Yeah. The more she was drinking, the more
and I was like, I just like, this is a bit. If you listen to once every year, you.
Yeah, man. Yeah, your wife's a real dope. I think the last time you were on, Christy, was November of 19. I think it's been 3.5, 4 years since you've been on the
show. There was that snowstorm.
Wow.
We tried to get her on, but she's like, I don't want
to
do it.
Right, yeah. She's like, I got better things to do, like mop the floor.
I don't like it.
I've got a pool now. Fuck you guys.
Oh, how's that going?
Oh, I love it. Yeah.
What are you doing right that Blake couldn't figure out? Because Blake had to remove his pool.
Because mine was 30 years old. My pool was 30 years old.
Yeah. That might be why, yeah.
Would you get another pool boy?
That takes care of the chemicals.
We had a fight about that the other day. No, we're not.
So your wife wants to, and you don't not. You do
that's
not
correct.
Want. But here's the thing: if you got one tomorrow, it wouldn't be 30 years old. It would be one day old.
a little wee little baby.
No, I don't need that. I don't need that.
Don't you miss doing cannonballs? God, I
wouldn't allow people to do cannonballs because it was so old that when they would jump in like that, the walls would just go like this.
Oh, no.
So do you guys actually go swimming or do you just do like the sunbathing?
I go swimming.
I swim.
She gets in. Dylan goes swimming. But
hey, Dylan, you got how did they?
Well, we got a little basketball hoop thing out there too.
So you'd rather have a basketball hoop than bring some chicks over?
No, he's an introvert.
The son Dylan's here. He's 15 years old. Before
he likes girls, but he's shy.
I'm a little shy guy.
Before we started recording, I said, "How much you doing a lot of drinking, right? Yeah, he says, "No, I'm not."
He's like, "Yeah, mom, I'm shy."
What is your as parents to a 15 year old boy? What is your stance on the boy drinking or partaking in cigarettes or you know, like maybe he smokes weed at a party or something?
I take a pretty good stance of not doing that.
Not doing any of that.
No.
No?
No.
But do you feel like he would be socially ostracized for not being able, for not participating in that or not?
Not the ones he hangs around. I think no. He's fine.
You hang around a bunch of dorks? A bunch of nerds?
It's the nerd herd.
That was not me in high school, by the way, at all. Like, I didn't touch alcohol at all in high school. And look where I am today. What about you? Do you align with that, Christy? Or do you?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Would you do some whoop ass on his ass? Would you?
Oh, yeah. Probably. So, he knows it.
Say he went to a party and he's like, Mom, I had three Bush Lights.
Peaches.
You could, Bush Light peach.
Hey, sissy boy, don't come home.
I don't know. I guess I would say I don't know. I'd probably be upset at first,
if he talks
to me about it, tells me about it. Or like but if he tries to keep secrets off. And shit, no.
Yeah,
no, me and Scott have always been real open with him. You know,
the first time my daughter, I think it was the first time that she drank, she told me about it, and I was like, as long as you were being safe, I know I cannot stop you from doing these things, so I'm not going to try to contain it or tell you not to do it.
Well,
or
because
you
if you do
it.
Like you said, they're going to do it three times more.
Friends that we had that I had in high school that they were PK, you know, preacher kids, and they were just buck wild.
Yeah,
just buck wild.
Because those parents were probably so
oppressive
about it.
Yes.
Be oppressive. Be oppressive.
Yeah. But you're saying you'd whip his ass if you did.
No. I wouldn't whip his ass, but I'd be disappointed.
He'd spank it. Not whip it, but spank
it. Disappointed too.
But would you nay-nay it?
I don't want to make too many waves in the pool here. But,
no, I don't.
But you guys, when you were in high school, we don't have to talk about it because I don't. Like I said, your boy's right here. He's not on mic. But when you were in high school, if you want to talk about it, did you partake?
Oh, good Lord.
And is there some sort of hypocrisy?
You do know that I've mentioned this on the show.
Corn chip.
When I was 17, when I was my sophomore year of high school, the first half of it was spent in a rehabilitation.
And your boy knows this already.
Yeah, he knows. Yeah.
Scott might be cool the most financially secure person I know. So
well,
as long as
she's we are together.
So as long as you guys... As
financially
long,
secure.
Yeah.
Oh.
She was like, hi? Did you say hi?
There's, you know, it's Rumspringa. You guys heard of Rumspringa before?
Yeah. It's where the Amish kids get to leave for 1 year and they get to do whatever they want.
Yeah. there is really something to that, not only for the Amish, but just people in general. Sometimes they have a gap year, whether they recognize it or not, where they go out there and they just kind of let it loose. You have to, like, you can't pinch it your whole life. You got to let it go a little bit, right?
Mm-hmm. You can't pinch it.
You know, you don't talk about.
Talking about. I know you're talking about poopy.
Yeah, I'm talking about poopy.
Oh boy.
Well, we are winding down the show here. We only have a handful of episodes left, and like we said up top, we really did want our most favorite people here, and Scott's one of our most favorite people. And he said we have to get the wives on because we love the wives, but we want that combination because I don't think we've ever had you on together. You've been here before, but I don't think you were really on mic with that episode.
No,
you,
I wasn't. No.
I was on your show, wasn't I?
Yeah, but okay. I was sitting over here supposed to be silent when you were on the show,
and that was Karaoke Big E, and that, so this combination has not happened.
No.
On Couch Pilots, and I wanted it to happen before we turned out the lights. So thank you for making the time to do it.
Not a problem.
You're welcome.
Blake, anything else you want to say here?
No, I'm just ready. I'm just ready to get this rolling and see how long it takes. It took my wife about 15 minutes to get mad at me, so I'm going to see how long it takes you get mad at me.
26 years. Is it 26 or 28?
28 together.
26 married. 28 together.
How do you do it?
Ask her how she does it.
Do you have to just compromise every single thing you've ever thought?
No, he does not compromise. He does not compromise anymore. He used to.
You know what's funny? Blake, is we'd have him on the past.
There's no compromise with him.
And we looked at the most part. With Scott, we're like, man, Scott, your wife's wearing the pants. She's kicking your ass every day. And then we have her on. She's like, no, he's in charge.
Oh, I didn't say he's in charge. I'm just saying that he just does.
She's like, I don't want to hurt his feelings in front of his friends.
Here, I bought this on this. Here you go.
This ambiguity, I think, is key to why it works.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. You guys have some sort of power agreement. Yeah. Can the boy is not on mic. Can you agree? What do you say about why your parents' relationship works so well, Dylan? All right, there's a reason you're not on mic.
Because they love each other.
Yeah, there's no such thing as love.
What is
love? Sounds like a man on the verge of his third divorce. Hey, today we discussed the pilot episode of Bubsy from the year of our Lord, 1900 plus 93. Hey, that was a great year.
1993, a great year. Good year for the roses. Bow, 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 bow.
So how old were you then? You were like 18.
Yeah, I was...
What does a good year for the roses mean, Scott?
It was a good year for roses to come up. It was nice and sunny.
But we're speaking in metaphors, yeah, though.
I don't remember what good year for the roses was.
Do you want to guess, Christy, what that means?
Good year for the roses? If I say...
Oh, Blake was having sex.
That was having sex.
That's what it Lord. Was.
But not like some sex. A lot of sex.
A lot of that. He was having all of it.
1985?
No, 1993.
He was having unresponsible sex.
Yeah, I was really fucking the hell out of people at 10 years old.
I don't know how old you are.
That's the year he got herpes simplex B.
Oh, jeez.
Blake is a year younger than me.
Oh, okay.
Almost.
Who looks younger? Come on. Who looks younger?
You guys both need to use a little of that Just for Men in your beard.
I used to.
But you got some gray. Well, nothing wrong with it. You look distinguished. But if you want to look younger,
I haven't shaved in a month. This is like coming in full, man.
How long is that really?
It's probably 3 weeks.
Is it really?
Yeah.
You'd have more on yours, and you're 15.
And what I've noticed is that my pubic hair grows. 6 times as fast.
Yeah, it does.
It makes no sense to me.
And it's red, right?
Huh?
Bright red.
Oh, my God.
It looks like Sideshow Bob down there.
Not anymore. It's summertime.
He's got a summer cut?
Yeah, he's got a summer. I was really feeling like a complex. I was like, man, my penis is so small.
Oh, my God.
And then I was like, if I just shave my pubic hairs, and now I look at it, it looks huge. But my belly's too big, and I still can't see it.
I shave my pubes in vertical lines so my dick
He's tall. He's tall. Look at him stand up.
Look how tall it is.
So tall. You can slam dunk a basketball, can't you?
All right, let's go back to 1993.
In our minds.
And to do so, we'll talk about things that happened in 1993. And specifically, I'm going to steal a bit from Radio Rewind, another podcast that I do, and talk about top 10 hits from this week in 1993. So we can be in the proper mind frame of when Bubsy was released, because to do it any other way... Oh, it'd be disingenuous.
Right. We can't look at this cartoon from 1993 and base it off the standards of life that we have today in 2023.
Right.
In 1993, we didn't have promo codes.
No.
Nobody knew what a promo code
was. No one could make any money and then try to evade taxes with promo codes back then.
And then in 1993...
Christy gets it.
Please tell me by 93 we had finally got Band-Aids.
No, nope. In 1993, we did not have 40 ounces.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you sure?
They came in glass bottles.
Oh, yeah.
But not the canned ones.
Not the canned ones.
Dylan, you ever go to a party and they tape 2 40 ounces to your hand?
Edward 40 hands.
Yeah. No, come on. Hanging out with nerds.
In 1993, they did not have training bras. If you had a breast at a very young age, you didn't
sink or swim.
You sink or swim. You did not get to train. There was no training involved. And then in 1993, we did not have Band-Aids.
Amen to that.
Still no Band-Aids.
Nope.
Damn.
Top 10 on the Billboard Hot
100. You can, I mean, that's true. In 1993, you did not have a training bra, did you?
Especially for three breasts.
93, you were a full.
I was a full. I was.
Exactly. But you didn't.
You were, well.
I was born in 76, so. 17. So
yeah, there you go. I was 19.
So, yeah.
Almost 19.
Yeah, no training bra.
No training bra. You guys were together since then. You went, regular bra.
We've been. You went straight to bra. 96. You didn't have no training, did you? No, I'm serious. Stupid. No training. No training.
Oh, my God.
No, no training. She woke up one morning and goes, give me the keys. I've got this shit.
No training.
I'm going to have back pain for the rest of my life. Let's go.
Dylan came in here and I was like, I know we're going to talk about my mom's boobs a lot. I can't wait to sit in a room with middle-aged
and
men.
And my Uncle Blake and Uncle Jason shave their balls. Oh, shit. Do a book report tomorrow. You'll get an A.
Top 10 Billboard Hot 100. Number 8, and I'm going to lean heavily on Scott on this because I know he's got information here. I know he's got remembrances. He's number 8, Dr. Dre with 1993 this week that year.
Are we talking albums or songs?
Songs.
Dr. Dre. But a G thing.
Dre Day.
Oh, Dre Day, yeah.
Dre Day. Mm-hmm. You, self-described corn chip, growing up in the Midwest, a lot of cornfields around. Corn chips were skater stoner boys, mm-hmm. and you were that guy.
I was that guy in grade school.
Were you? Were
By
you
this time, I was a sporto.
Were you listening to hip-hop, though? Or
oh, not? Yeah, 100. I've listened to hip-hop since 1985.
I really feel like, out of all the guys I know, like you know the most about old-school hip-hop. Yep. And I'm not blowing smoke. I really do, because sometimes it comes up, and you're quick to it. Mm-hmm. I co-hosted that show with you for a year. That knowledge would pop up from time to time. Were you a big Dr. Dre guy?
Yep. I had The Chronic. Oh, yeah. I had that album.
That was a huge bumping. Album. Huge album. Chrissy, what kind of music were you listening to back then?
I listen to everything.
Mm-hmm. Except, okay.
Well, except for the headbanging shit.
Wilson and Phillips?
Oh, well, yeah.
Read out Wilson and Phillips?
The Bengals? I remember, yes.
What else you got, Blake?
The girl from the Bengals, lead singer, I was in love with her.
Is that Susanna Hoffs?
Came across her.
Belinda Carlisle?
Belinda?
No, that's the other band.
That was the Go-Go's.
Yeah. Oh, jeez.
The Bengals chick was hotter, but she came across my Instagram the other day. I was like, whew, the years are not helping her.
Well, shame on you for clicking on her and expecting
her to look click on her. I was randomly going. It's after, like, all the people I follow, like, I finish, and then they give you, like, you're all done with the people you know, and now here, you degenerate bastard. Now look at all these people.
Oh, you're
and that's the ones that Molly catches me looking at. I'm like, I'm not following her. Why is she on your Instagram? I don't know.
Did you hear Scott just start singing? You miss Karaoke Biggie.
I do.
You missed it.
Are you reeling in the years? Little Steely Dan.
Hey, number 7, Rod Stewart with.
No, that would have been.
Any question? Oh, any guess? 1993. This is late onset Stewart.
Yeah, this would be.
The only one I want to sing, but it's too old.
Sing
if
it.
You want my body, that's from think of 70s.
Have I told you lately?
Have I told you lately that I love you? Yes. Can't do it.
That was a good one.
Can't do it.
All right, and number 3, getting towards the top of the charts. I picked these three out specifically for this group of people. Number 3, tag team with.
Whoop! There it is. Oh.
Hell yeah.
Tag team back again. What the record? Let's begin. Party, peace, noise. DC's in the house. Jump for joy. There's party over here. Party over there. Wave hands in the air. Shake the air. Yeah. These three words when you're getting busy.
Whoop. There it is.
Let me hear you say.
Whoop. There it is.
Dylan's like, that sounds like a stupid fucking song.
I like that song.
Okay, all right.
Weren't they in a commercial recently?
Yes.
For like, was it like chocolate or something? Or
something.
Like,
some
yeah,
item.
I remember it, yeah. It was chocolate, like a chocolate ice cream or something.
I don't remember.
Everything. It was like Cool Whip. Whip there. Was it Cool Whip or not? Something like that.
Something.
Everything that it was decent or at least popular, not necessarily good, but everything like that has a return.
Mm-hmm.
So if you liked the Rednecks, Cotton Eye Joe, it's gonna come back sometime.
It's gonna come back.
God. Cotton Eye Joe's gonna come back. Hey, I was 12 years old when this pilot was released. I'm obviously one of the youngest ones in the room.
I was 18 years
Very
old.
Very handsome. You're 18, yeah.
I had life to go.
18. You were probably 19 then.
Yep.
17.
17, yeah. Yeah.
Dylan wasn't even a thought.
No one was thinking about
it. Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure he had thought about it.
He was too busy not drinking at a party. Hey, Christy, why did we choose to watch Bubsy? Oh, there are three reasons here on the Couch Pilots program that we do anything.
Don't look at your husband at all. Do not look at him.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't look at him.
Three. Quit looking at him.
Three reasons.
Three reasons why we chose this pilot to watch.
There are wrong answers.
Because it's stupid.
All right.
Because the armadillo gets killed a lot.
Okay.
Oh, and spoiler because, alert.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. We like to have the deaths of armadillos
free.
Because it's an old cartoon. I don't know. I have boring answers.
You did great. I think you did great.
Let me take a shot.
Oh, hold on. Let's reset the... Okay, go ahead.
It was free. It was on the internet.
All right.
And there's only one episode, and none after that.
You know what my favorite part of Biggie just doing that? Not only did he say, well, let me take a stab because my wife didn't know him. He paused after each one, waiting for his cheer. You know what? That's a fucking baller right there.
Validation.
He's like, I know this fucking show. I'm going to get my applause.
I haven't listened to it in like 2 years, but I still know the foundation of this show. I did listen to the last episode I was on and then listen to the one after that.
That made it worth. That was awesome, Big E. You just totally balled out on that. I love it.
Thank you.
Hey, Big E, way to ball out.
Ball out.
All right, that's enough of that.
Flight attendants?
Haven't listened for 2 years?
Yeah, probably. That audio clip has been like that for seven years.
I know. That's the first time I heard it.
It's corrupted.
It's a corrupted file. It's a demi file.
Yes, I agree. Summary of the pilot.
Are you guys booking like travel plans or like on DraftKings.com making a bunch of bets? You and your son are just like, it's like you've...
Snapchats.
You're Snapchatting with your son?
No.
He's right here. He's next to you.
No,
you guys are
with
touching
my
arms.
Friends.
You guys can get in the
with
same...
With my friends. Hard to believe. Yes, I actually have friends. Yes, I was Snapchatting my friends.
What do you Snapchat your friends? What do you Snapchat?
Oh, I Snapchatted my husband.
To your friends?
Yes.
That's actually pretty sweet.
It is.
That she would Snapchat her
That's
husband.
Cute. It's like, look at this buffoon doing a fucking podcast. I told him this is stupid.
I think I know the answer to this.
And they're all snapping back. I'm like, my husband's got his hand down his pants.
This is personal. We don't have to get in it. But do you guys sleep in the same room?
No.
No.
Okay. I think that's the smartest thing you can do. I'm not joking. If I had a partner or if I was married to someone, I don't think I could sleep in the same room. I am farting the sheets off the bed all night. If I touch you while I'm sleeping, I'm waking up and I'm miserable the next day. You got that? Seriously, Blake, that might be the secret to 26 years of marriage. No joke.
No, my grandparents, they had rooms on separate sides of the house. Mm-hmm. My mom and my stepdad for many, many years had separate rooms. If I can just get rid of these fucking dogs, I can have my own room. Mm-hmm. I think it'd be great too, because then I'm not getting rejected every night. I'm just going into a bed. There's no chance in hell. Like you walk in the same room, you're like, oh, I just took her clothes off, you know? Hey, yeah. And then you're like, hey, and hey. But now you're just like slam doors, put both in different rooms. It's great.
Let's see.
Jerk off without people bothering me.
I was on third shift when Dylan was first born.
He's like, this kid's too fucking loud. I gotta get my own room.
I had my, so I slept in our bed without her, and it just
during the day while she was at work or something.
Well, and then I snore like a freight train.
Yeah,
so it works out better that way.
I've only been there. I've known Scott for like almost 10 years at this point. I've only been invited to his house once. but like the one time I was there, I think you gave me the tour. I think we found out we have the same shower curtain.
Yes.
I still have the same one.
So do I.
But you have a room in the basement, which is, it's got to be the best. You can completely shut that off from all light, and you can lose all, it's like a casino in there. Yeah. You can lose track of all time and just sleep for all day.
You could. Oh, yeah, 100%.
Because there's no windows in there.
No windows.
Shut the door.
Shut the door.
Do you guys find that this has been beneficial for the marriage?
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. I mean,
why are you waiting for me to answer?
Well, I don't know.
He knows the rules.
I mean,
she's like, I can literally still hear him. If I don't turn my fan on by my head, I can still hear him downstairs snoring.
But it's way better than if he was 3 inches from me.
Oh, yes. So I'd probably have to smother him with a pillow.
So, yes, the answer is it is better, right?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
God, I got a couple uncles who are gay guys. They have their own separate bedrooms. People who do that, they've got it figured out.
Let's get you on.
My grandma.
You know, I know a lot of people, though, that do that. Like, there's a lot of people.
Her grandma and grandpa.
It was nice to actually talk about it, because it was like, yes, I've never wanted to say anything.
That's exactly right.
So I'm like, I'm so embarrassed. Is there shame
around it? Do you feel like there's shame
around
it?
Not now.
Good.
Because I used to. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah,
I did.
That's exactly right.
I was like, oh my God, I don't want to tell anybody. But I was like.
But now you Snapchat it. You're like, this is me in my room by myself.
But it's cool. You do. You get your own room. You get to do with it, decorate however you want. And then you get to sleep without having to worry about waking them up or about them waking you up. I'm glad there's no shame around it. That's smart.
He just needs to be a little more neater.
Oh, yeah.
But you don't go into his room, do you?
Yes, I do.
Oh.
Pound town.
5:15 in the morning, I am farting it up. It's serious. I use this a lot, but it sounds like someone's dropping a barrel of apples down some stairs. It's best. I can't put that on another person in my room. You know, I've got to have a separate place to do it. Anyway. That's good. And I did want to ask Christy also, you got a new job in the past, I don't know, year or two, but before that you had a job where you really did carry a gun.
Yes.
But were you, so you worked for a company that helped transport money?
Yes.
Okay. So, but you never transported the money, right?
No.
But, so why did you have a gun?
Just in case. Well, tell them why.
Because I worked in the building, so if
but,
anyone.
But there was money in that building. Okay, I don't know. I'm not saying the name of the place. I'm not saying where it was. I'm not saying anything like that.
Okay.
And honestly, I'm not even 100% sure which one it is. I have some ideas, but I'm not going to say it. But there was money in that building. So there was a chance that you could be robbed, and every employee there has got a 9mm on their hip. Yeah?
90% of them, yes.
Okay.
I don't know how it is now.
Jeez.
I know how it was when I worked there.
That 10% that didn't have one, what the fuck was their problem? Why didn't they get one?
They're shit out of luck.
Irresponsible, can't get a FOID card.
When you got that job, did you had to take some sort of training, right, with the gun?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
So they taught you how to use the gun, how to be responsible?
She's like, I didn't have a training, bro. I don't need to lesson. Just gave her the gun and she just started popping.
Yeah, she had a false third tit where the gun was. Is that
we
what
had gun training twice a year. So
that's insane, yeah. Okay.
That's pretty fucking hot, to be honest with you.
Yeah, Blake's
it reminded me, I had a girlfriend who was a Mountie cop. No, I'm serious.
She rode a horse.
She was a
She had a three-way with the lady and the horse.
Look at him. He's not denying it.
Save a horse, ride a cowboy.
Just like they shouldn't be ashamed of sleeping apart, you shouldn't be ashamed about sleeping with that horse.
Yeah, it's dangerous.
It is. Oh, my God.
People think, oh, it's a horse. That's no big deal. No, it's a big deal. You got to get a stool and not get kicked.
You have to earn their trust.
Yeah. It's my pinky finger.
All right. Summary of the pilot. Bubsy tries to save the world while also babysitting for his nephew and niece. That's the summary. Blake, why don't you pave the path here and grade that summary.
We're going to grade the summary based off of like school grades, A, B, C, D, E, or F. Okay? I would say... Well, Biggie, you go first. What do you grade?
Bubsy tries to save the world while also babysitting for his nephew and niece.
B+.
B+.
Okay.
Christy, what do you think?
Just your the summary. You're grading the summary.
Not the pilot. Just the summary.
Just the summary.
Oh, a B.
Just throwing Bs out there like
a
villain.
Okay, B.
Why are you looking to your son?
Have you said anything that's been your own thought, or is it all coming from the boy?
She's in. We asked her a question.
Well, because what I wanted to say was lower than that. But well, you mean?
Yeah, you thought you were...
Dylan, are you not sleeping in the same bed as your
dad
anymore?
I thought I was grading the cartoon. No. Sorry. So I'm
well, if
grading.
You had quit Snapchat, you would know that we're just doing the summary.
Are we not entertaining?
Okay,
are you not having fun?
Are you not having a good time?
I'll say B, B minus.
You're not entertained?
This is a personal affront to me.
Stop it. Shut up, Jason.
If you're being controlled, blink at me twice.
Oh, no.
Hey, And my response to that is, Scott, call way to buddy. Fucking go. Teach me. I'll be your grasshopper.
What do you say, Blake?
I'd say a B+.
Oh, so everyone's kind of right around a B.
Yeah.
All right. How about this? Interesting facts.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Interesting Facts. This is the part of the show where Jason has scoured the internet to find out facts about this show that you may not know. All we ask is that you do not share your opinions. We do not want you to taint someone else's experience.
He said taint.
Did you get that? Did you get that?
He said taint.
What constitutes a good-looking taint? Do you think any of them are good-looking? It's just a question. I've got opinions of what
it's
makes
a forbidden area between the butthole and the vagina. Or
it's kind of like a bridge.
It's like the bridge.
Anyway, Jason has scoured the internet. He's got facts. Don't state your opinion. You can comment on them, but don't give your opinion on them.
A great taint would be virtually hairless and without blemish.
That's true.
Or blemish free is what I should have said.
Blemish free.
That taint ain't gonna happen.
Not gonna happen.
a terrifying look
into Scott's taint.
That ship sailed a long time ago. I don't know what happened. I don't remember if I fell like on a tree branch. Oh, yeah. But that shit don't look good anymore.
Yeah, my taint is almost.
I'm so fat. I couldn't tell you the last time I saw my taint.
Oh boy.
Well, you just take your phone and you go down there.
Selfie stick.
Huh? Selfie stick. You just got to move your dick over and then.
I think it's fair to say that most selfie sticks are only being utilized to look at one's own taint.
Sure. I think that's why they invented that.
I think they should change the name of the selfie stick to the taint stick.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
What do you mean, a taint Ooh. Stick? No, it's a
taint stick. That sounds like something you get like at La Gondola.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. I'll have an order of taint sticks.
I'll get some garlic knots, some taint stick, marinara dip. Oh, Bubsy is a series of platforming video games created by Michael Berlin and developed and published by Accolade. The games star an anthropomorphic bobcat named Bubsy, a character that takes inspiration from Super Mario Brothers and Sonic the Hedgehog. The games were originally released for the Super NES, Mega Drive / Genesis, Game Boy, Jaguar, PC, and PlayStation during the 1990s. Fact. Bubsy also had a pilot episode for an animated series sponsored by Taco Bell in 1993 entitled What Could Possibly Go Wrong?
Fact.
Calico Entertainment and Imagination Factory jointly produced the pilot for airing on Bobot Communications Kids Day Off syndication package for Thanksgiving on November 28, 1993 at 7 a.m. on Fox 53, a slightly altered version, was included on the PC video game Super Bubsy as an Easter egg.
If you collected 10 houses.
Look at you. Look at you.
Holla back.
Your research. Blake said, how many episodes we got left? I'll start trying.
I'm going to put a little effort into this one. I had no idea it was a
video game. I didn't either.
The aforementioned Calico Entertainment and Imaginary Factory, known for cartoons like Denver the Last Dinosaur, The Adventures of Zorro, and Bad Baby. Also, Cy Young Animation, a studio based in
Catch
South Korea.
Catch me outside.
How about that? South Korea was hired to do the animation and known for cartoons like Super Mario Brothers, Super Show, The Legend of Zelda, and The Adventures of Super Mario Brothers 3. Fact. Thank you.
Fact.
It featured new additions to the Bubsy franchise, not only made by the original Bubsy producer Michael Berlin, as he was on hiatus from Accolade at the time. These included Virgil Reality, that was one of the characters from the show, a genius inventor and scientist, Oblivia, who was Virgil's assistant and planned future love interest for Bubsy, Ally, the main antagonist, along with Buzz and Sid, her two henchmen. Fact. Virgil later appeared as a playable character in Bubsy Paws on Fire. Fact. I've got a few more. There's a lot of information about Bubsy out there. Rob Paulsen has stated that he regrets voicing Bubsy in this cartoon, and the makers of Bubsy video games absolutely hated this cartoon. Fact. All right, just a couple more. Super Bubsy, a PC remake of the first game, contained a copy of the pilot given to the player if they collected 10 television sets in the game. The Super Bubsy pilot is 3 minutes longer than what ended up getting aired on TV. Many scenes were cut and some music and lines were changed. The voice actor that uttered the line after these messages is also different. Now that's a fact.
Jack.
Put it in your pocket.
Boy, there is. Here's a. Are you guys ready for a long one or not?
Mm-hmm.
I do it.
Well, hold on. We're going to Snapchat it. Go ahead.
You want to Snapchat us real quick?
I'm telling him to.
Do we need to take our shirts off?
We don't have to. Take
I don't know.
I'm telling him, his phone keeps going off. It's driving me bonkers. Well, I told him put it in his pocket. Okay, bye.
How many people do you snap? Obviously, these are all girlfriends that you're Snapchatting. Oh, yeah. How many is in a group? Do you have a group going?
No.
So you individually send pictures? You don't know. And you got any single ones in there? I'll take that as a yes, and we'll talk later. All right, Jason, go ahead. I'm sorry. Just trying to work on things happening.
Work on things happening. A sentence that makes sense.
This wasn't working now.
Hey, Accolade teamed up with Software Etc. and held a contest that required fans to watch the pilot episode on TV and write down their three favorite characters on an entry form attached to a flyer. This form had to be cut off and sent to the accompanied address. A postcard was handed out prior to the pilot's release. This flyer was originally included with Bubsy 1 for the Sega Mega Drive and listed three prizes that could be won. The grand prize was a trip to Hollywood, an opportunity to see Calico Studios. The first prize entry contains a possible spelling error. Either Bubsy's trademark exclamation t-shirt or the same shirt that would be given away with the Bubsy 2 cartridge a year later, and the second prize, a couple of iron-on patches. It's not been documented who won or if the contest was canceled in the end. Fact. That was a long one. I'm sorry.
See, I was poor during this time, so I didn't have video games. I did not realize how big this video game was.
I'd never heard of it either.
I think I've never heard of it either.
I was aware of it. I don't think I ever played it, but there's like three games in the early 90s.
I was getting laid, so why would I be playing a video game?
Exactly, oh, and I was 12. And I was 12.
Does your brother have any of these in his store?
He might. His store is rocking. Have you been down there?
Yeah, I've been down there.
Yeah, that's pretty good. finally, the last interesting fact. The real...
Bloomington.
What's that? My brother's got a video game store in Bloomington. It does pretty well. He also runs the video game convention. Have you heard of that?
Yeah, we've went. I thought we went to one. Me, you, and Dylan went to one.
At this point, it was about 2 weeks ago when this releases. But I'm very excited that it's coming up quick, the video game. I hope you guys can make it. It's going to be a lot of fun.
I probably can't.
Why not?
It's on Saturday, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yep.
No, you're going to go. you're going to go. You like video games, Dylan?
Yeah.
Did you go to the video game convention before?
You went with us once, yeah.
Do you like professional wrestling? There's going to be professional wrestling there.
Do you like naked girls?
What?
What? He was like, what? That's a stupid question. Look at my phone.
Yeah, no shit.
The real life footage that appeared in the pilot came from several movies, film archives, and NASA. 9 clips were used in total, of which 8 have been found the origin of and of interesting.
Great job. Had a lot of info.
Good thing I have the wherewithal to not state my opinion on facts.
You're good.
All right, and that's it. Twitter responses.
Twitter responses. Twitter responses. I wonder if Jason got some. Come on, Biggie. Twitter responses.
No, I didn't.
No, I didn't.
Let's go ahead and put 10 minutes on the clock here.
Bing, bing.
And let...
Bing, bong.
Let's talk about Bubsy. It's was it like 25 minutes maybe?
Yeah, 20 something.
With commercials.
Yeah. Scott, I know you know the rules. You chime in whenever you want. Chrissy, I hope to God you chime in with your thoughts.
Yeah, because if you're quiet for the next 10 minutes, we're just going to quit doing the show.
hold on. Before we start, did you say I kind of saw it?
She was on the couch while all three of us were watching it.
What was she doing on the couch?
So what does that mean you kind of saw it? How much did you see?
I felt bad for the armadillo.
We'll get okay, into so the that. First 3 minutes.
Yes. We'll get into that.
No. I saw it. I saw some of it.
Well, please chime in with your remembrances as we go along.
Okay, as you go along, I'll comment.
Bubsy wakes up. He polishes his face, eats some cereal, slides out of his house.
And everything's going perfect. I mean,
Yeah, yeah. It's like,
it's like that Bill Withers song.
It's right. Perfect day. That's right.
Lovely day.
Lovely day.
Lovely day.
Throws the cereal in the air after he, you know, it goes into the bowl. The milk goes in. He throws his bowl and his stuff into the sink.
Sudsy sink.
Sorry, yeah. It's already sudsy.
Yeah,
well, already.
He was probably washing
pre-suds.
He was probably washing off sin.
Is that what you think?
Yes.
He does all this and it goes right into a title card and he says, "What could possibly go wrong?
What could possibly go wrong?"
An interesting fact that some people may not know, when you saw that, what it said, the title of the show was What Could Possibly Go Wrong? It looked like Windows, like some font that they already had preloaded in Windows.
Yeah.
It was actually not. This came out, and this font was on there before Windows came out with that font.
Ooh.
Oh, wow.
If I'm not mistaken, it's called Jade Hill or something is the name of the font. I looked up that interesting fact. Did you have that and already say it? Oh, it's true.
Well done.
It's damn true.
It's right. Damn true.
You guys ever like have something that's about ready to end and then someone starts to care about it?
Yeah, sex.
You guys ever? You guys ever do that? This like, a podcast that's about to end and like one of the co-hosts like suddenly gets his ass into gear. Has that ever happened to you guys?
Never happened to me.
Jeez.
The show is bright and loud and full of energy. Bubsy wakes up his buddy Arnold the Armadillo, and he's having a dream where he's getting hit by a semi-truck.
Right. Or this armadillo, boy.
I know.
He's like a nervous Nelly,
oh,
right?
Oh, yeah. Scared of everything.
He's scared of everything. Also, Bubsy has a bowling alley in his house. Yes. I don't know if you guys noticed.
Yes. I did.
Pretty impressed with that.
I saw the sign. Like, there's a bowling alley sign or something behind it. I didn't realize there was an actual bowling alley. Bubsy is an orange. He's like a bobcat. He's naked except for a white T-shirt with an exclamation point.
Yes!
It's like the most generic thing he could be wearing. I don't know. The armadillo is wearing nothing.
Nothing.
And he's a very nervous fellow, and he kind of cements himself as Bubsy's sidekick.
And I think that an armadillo I would consider a very scared animal. Right? That's why they have a shell, and that's why they can. Is this they're just nervous all the time?
Their response is not to run away. Their response is not to fight. It's to curl up in a ball.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that makes sense. Bubsy's twin niece and nephew arrive. And they're even more loud and obnoxious than Bubsy. On TV, this nerd, is he a rat? Virgil? What's his name? Virgil?
Virgil reality. Yeah, he's a rat.
Virgil reality. He's
see,
a rat.
Are we passing up the commercials and not talk about those?
I didn't. There was no commercials in our
version. I watched a different link. Oh,
yeah, you
shit.
Did.
Tell us about the commercials.
Bro. Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Because we saw no commercials.
Yeah,
okay.
We didn't either.
Yeah, they had the bubble shower Barbie. It was a shower. And it was a bubble machine, and you could put the Barbie in there, and it would make bubbles.
I remember that.
This is very important.
Look how excited
that I will cut all of you motherfuckers off
do
when
it.
We
no,
get to the
it.
Commercials, because you will notice a weird-ass pattern. And I'm going to okay, I'm sorry. I'm very excited. I
Blake's got a beautiful mind.
To watch something completely different. Then there's a Wednesday morning cartoon ad, and it's like these two adults, and the one guy's like trying to be hip and cool, and and they're rapping like about the cartoon lineup, and it has like the Pink Panther, and but it was really odd. Then there was a commercial for Bugles, the snack,
sure, yeah,
starring Doc Severinsen from The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson.
Yeah, he's the orchestra leader. Yeah, and honestly, still alive today.
Yes,
Doc Severinsen's still alive.
And finally, a 38-hour furniture sale, and
38 hours.
It was no 36. I'm sorry, 36. 36-hour furniture sale. I could have gotten a recliner for $59 in 1993.
Wow!
And a beautiful lamp for only $18.
Oh wow!
Wow.
Where was this at?
Look at Blake's nose.
It was in Pittsburgh.
The place where you get the onion.
Because a Fox 53, Fox 53 is out of Pittsburgh. Wow. Did you guys watch this at all?
We did not.
We did not have commercials.
No.
Like it would pause and then it would go back to the show.
Guess what?
It would.
Wow.
Look how excited. I've never seen Blake like
this. I don't want to talk about the pilot anymore. I just want to go through the commercials. Sorry. Go ahead. Well, because you guys were going, I was like, wait, the art fork. We got to go talk about Bubble Barbie before we get to that.
On the TV, we see Virgil, and he's created a helmet that makes your imagination, whatever you think of it, comes true. Bubsy decides
you have to think of it and then blink twice.
I mean, there was Okay, so I thought this was advanced, but there were things, virtual reality, kind of speaking of back in the 90s, right?
I remember, I have a vague memory of me being like 12 years old. I had some friends with from church. We went down to the St. Louis Six Flags. And on the way down, we stopped at the Union Station. Now, I was there last year. It's the first time I've been there in probably 20-plus years. Totally different. But back in the day, it used to be a big mall. Three stories. I think the third floor was entirely a Hooters. They had the fudgery where the black kids would be down there making fudge and singing and dancing. I think we've talked about that
before. Yeah.
But that was a cool place, man. In the back of the Union Station, you could go, and for like $4 for like 5 or 10 minutes, which is a lot of money back then, you could play a virtual reality game. Virtual reality did exist in some form in 1993. I experienced it. Now it's totally different. It's better now.
Yeah.
But back then, yeah, it did exist.
Yeah, there we go.
Sorry for the tangent.
Oh, I love your tangents. That's why I've been in this relationship for so long.
Bubsy decides he wants to be the test subject for that helmet that Virgil made. And then we get some live. This is the first of like three times we get live stock footage of people.
Right, Bubsy is like points out three things of why he should be, because he's brave, and then it cuts to something
else. Oh yeah, yeah.
Elsewhere, we get this awful and rich feline. I think they said her name was
Allie.
Allie.
Oh, Allie.
Probably like a
the
cat.
The one that
Allie
she
cat.
Wished for the what 30? Was it 30 carat ring?
Later in the show, carat. Yeah,
50
yeah.
carat. Sorry,
her last name was longer. It was Allie Cass something. It was longer.
Well, she has this vulture. I thought it was a vulture, but we find out it's a buzzer. And he's a personal chef.
And it wasn't the voice of that the guy from Thurston Howell? Thurston Howell?
No. From Exeronius.
Oh, I don't know.
I don't think it was the same guy, but it was the same accent. You're absolutely
yes, the
right.
Same,
I thought about it. It's called the Locust Valley Lockjaw.
It's when someone talks like
that's a guy from Gilligan's Island.
Yeah.
Thurston Howell had it, absolutely. And then you're right too. Daniel Butler, who we were in communication with, oddly enough, from the Ernest franchise, who was in Ernest Goes to Camp. Yes, it's the exact same accent. You guys are both correct. And then a weasel, which we find out it's not a weasel, it's a shrew.
It's a shrew.
And his name is Sid.
Sid the shrew, and he's always hungry.
She sends them, she says, you know what, guys, you guys work for me. Go get that helmet for me, I want it. Bubsy arrives at Virgil's reality lab to test the helmet, and Virgil has like this ditzy cat assistant. I think her name is Oblivia.
Yeah, she's oblivious. And she always gets... throughout the pilot, she gets Bubsy's name wrong every time she...
Yes, she does.
Every time.
And at one time, he gets really fucking pissed. I thought he was going to slap her.
Shit, we were getting it wrong.
Bubsy gets instructions on how to use the helmet. He thinks of flying, and then him and everyone else around him start falling out of the sky. And then the armadillo Arnold gets it, and he thinks of a semi hitting him.
Every time.
And then Bubsy puts the helmet back on. He gets everyone back to the lab safely, I think, except Arnold, who comes crashing through the roof.
Mm-hmm. Okay, one of the things I thought to myself, because that's how I refer to myself, mm-hmm. self.
Right.
I was like, since when does virtual reality involve everyone that's with you?
Exactly.
I found that to be odd.
I did too.
And then... right after that happened, and they get right before when the twins go outside, we have another commercial break. Sorry,
break it down, please.
This is really the only thing I'm talking about.
I want to hear him.
Tyrannosaurus Rocks game. Now, what this was, it was like a skeleton of a Tyrannosaurus Rex, and you had to put the bone. You know, to start the timer, and you had to put the bones on it, and the last person to go, and it starts to vibrate and like freak out, you lose. Like we've seen those games, right? Yeah, like,
there's a timer on it. You gotta do something.
It's like operation, you know,
kind of. Yeah,
you're the doctor collecting all that pay, right?
Yeah. But it was a very scary commercial for like a 7-year-old toy. Then there was it was a ball. It was a plastic ball that had like round spikes on it and just vibrated.
Yeah,
I
had one.
Yeah, I wrote.
I don't know what the hell.
It wasn't a Buggle ball. It was a bungle ball.
It was a round ball with spikes.
Yes. Yeah, it was hard round. Yeah,
is that what you bought from Lover's Playground?
No, nope. You'll have to wait till episode 400. Nuts. And this is where we start to take a turn. It doesn't get really bad till the end.
You said throughout the commercials you noticed some sort of pattern.
Well, I just think it gets very odd, and think of what I've said so far.
Sure, sure.
All right. Then after that kid's toy that like a five-year-old would have, right, we have a Make-A-Wish Foundation commercial starring a Pittsburgh Penguin that I don't even remember what his name was. And if
Mario
you do-
Lemieux.
No, no, this was somebody who I did not know. If you donated $20 to the Make-A-Wish Foundation, you would receive a free cell phone and bag.
A cell phone?
With in a bag.
A so, oh, the bag phone.
Oh, my God, a bag phone.
Yeah.
For $20.
If you donated $20.
Your bill, though, was $1,000 a month.
Right. That's exactly right. It was like it was like a dollar a minute.
Yeah.
And then, finally, on this one, there is a... It says, do you need a job? And I was like, no, I've got one. It's a very good job. Thank you very much. I'm making fairly good money. But... you can become a respiratory therapist. You can go to school. So it's an advertisement for this respiratory therapy school in Pittsburgh.
There you go.
Okay, now back to the show because I got one more commercial break.
One more commercial break.
So the twins want to play with the helmet. Virgil says no, but it actually gets on one of the twins. I think the twin was named Terry or something. I don't know. Meanwhile, the vulture or the buzzard and the what was the other one? Was it a rat? Or
yeah,
it was a shrew.
It was a shrew.
They make their way to Virgil's lab.
Yeah, they're flying over there.
And as they arrive, the twins are fighting over the helmet in front of the lab, and they wish for a boat and a pony, and then a roller coaster. And they get on the roller coaster with that buzzard and shrew.
Yeah, because they're still trying to get it. Mm-hmm. And before they get on the roller coaster, the buzzard and the shrew they're chasing after the twins. Classic cactus bit. Where they're going too low, and Sid keeps hitting the cactus.
Oh, he's the buzzard's carrying the shrew too low to the.
But not only do they want the helmet, they also want the two twins, bobcats, so they can have them as stew.
I didn't know. I didn't pick that up till later. Yeah.
No, that was the buzzard's intention the first time he laid eyes on
him. And he's not a turkey. He was a buzzard.
He's not a turkey. Yes. Bubsy and crew exit the lab to see the outside is a roller coaster, as one of the twins had wished. Virgil is freaking out, and Bubsy vows to return the helmet. We get more live-action footage here.
But what could go wrong, or whatever his tagline was.
What could possibly go wrong? Uh-huh. We get a roller coaster sequence with the twins and the buzzard and the shrew, and Bubsy's hanging on the back. And then the twins, they jazz up the roller coaster to make it even more exciting until Bubsy tells them to stop. And once they do, they immediately stop and eject everyone from the roller coaster.
Well, because the twins, and when they fall, the twins go, they should have had their seatbelts on. Mm.
the twins then make themselves huge or something and step on Arnold and Bubsy.
Ooh, I stepped on something squishy.
This is like, at this point, it's like, there's no rhyme or reason to anything that's happening.
Except for Bubsy wants to save the world. That's,
yeah, these are just like...
He wants to be a hero.
These are ideas just thrown against the wall, and they said, yeah, use it, use it, use it. These are just a bunch of like random, I don't know, there's...
Very animaniac.
That's actually good.
Anyway, the buzzard then drops the weasel on the kids and steals the helmet before Bubsy catches him. The shrew, I'm sorry. The Bubsy trades the helmet for a corn dog, which is...
Because he's always hungry.
But it seems like it's dynamite. It seems like it's going to blow up.
Yes.
But it doesn't explode.
No, it does.
No.
It does?
It does explode. Well, on the one I watched, it explodes.
I think it...
You might have missed the cut. Because he said something like about it exploding to the buzzard.
Did you guys get that on yours or not?
I don't remember. I know that he ate a corn dog that had a fuse in his mouth, and the buzzard did ask what it was, and he goes, "It's a fuse." But I don't remember if it exploded in the
right
version
after that.
We watched.
The buzzard flies by with the shrew, takes the twins and the helmet.
Right.
I don't remember there being any explosion. Yeah. I thought that shrew was going to be exploded.
I saw that. Yeah. they take it back to Allie, and she puts the helmet on. And the first thing, like Christian said, she wants the 50-carat ruby ring.
Mm-hmm. 50-carat ruby ring.
She wishes for that, a jacuzzi, and a love seat. And this is where I first hear, like, oh, they're going to eat those kids. Yes. That buzzard is going to eat those children. Yeah.
I was with Jason, though. I didn't catch on to that till it was almost over.
Speaking of catching on,
here we go.
We got a television break.
All right. I'm ready.
Now, you never heard. Did you have Barbies back in the day?
Oh, yes.
You didn't have the shower, the bubble shower?
I didn't have it, but my friend.
You
did.
Would remember.
I remember.
It was
no,
amazing.
I remember it. I remember
you
it.
You had Ken lay down on top of her.
God, here we go.
But on this one,
when are they going to make an anatomically correct Ken? That's what I want to know.
Looks just like mine. You can buy the Barbie paint and dazzle car.
Oh.
This is where you could paint and bedazzle the Barbie car yourself.
Nice.
And overnight it dried. It looked so cheesy. It was stupid. So you're thinking, hey, cartoons.
Yeah.
Probably going to have some more commercials about cartoons or toys or cereal, maybe, right? That'd be good.
Oh, yeah. I love cereal.
Oh, nope.
I do love cereal.
They do the answer and win commercial for what you wrote.
They did have that in there. So that contest.
Yes.
Yeah.
And if you called in, and then the parents would win $100.
Nice.
The kid won toys or whatever, but yeah. The next one was a drinking and driving lawyer commercial. It's like, it's the holidays are coming and everybody's celebrating. What you don't want to do is get drunk and get a DUI. And I was like, well, okay. And finally, there is a kid in a wheelchair.
Yeah.
And he has a support dog, and it's showing this kid who is barely strong enough to get this wheelchair by himself, and this dog that looks like he is an idiot trying to pick up a pencil for Andrew. The dog's name, I don't remember, but the kid's name was Andrew.
You got all this from a commercial?
Oh yeah, it was a commercial for support dogs.
And they told you the name of the dog in the commercial.
Yeah, they told me the kid's name and the dog's name, but I think it was Woody. I think it was Andrew and Woody, I think.
Okay, gotcha.
Andrew's Woody.
Andrew's Woody.
He was picking up a pencil off the floor. But he was like, but at the beginning of it, it's like his kids, like the only, he's like in the school hallway by himself, struggling because he's not really strong enough to do this. Mm-hmm. And this dog's kind of pulling him a little bit. And they're like, Andrew was in the sand pit and all his friends left and he couldn't get out. But now he's got So the support dog to help him. It was God. Okay, well maybe
that's Pittsburgh.
That's Pittsburgh for you.
Really, really affected you, Blake.
I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. Let's see. Back at the lab, Bubsy is lamenting his loss and beating himself over the head, literally with Arnold the Armadillo. Bubsy builds himself.
He always has to suffer.
He does. He's the punching bag of the show. Bubsy builds himself back
now
up.
Now I know how I feel. I feel like an aardvark. That's my spirit animal.
Wait till he rolls himself up in a corner. Bubsy builds himself back up, and Virgil gives him a helmet locator, which he says he doesn't need. Like, this is it's a weird thing. He says, here's this thing. You can find the helmet. He's
you can find it. I mean, it's going to lead you right to it. No, I don't need it.
I don't want it.
I don't need it.
He looks up where, I don't know how he knows the name of the people that took.
Yeah.
But he looks up their phone number and
calls them. But it's not even under Callie. It's under the frickin' shrew.
Isn't that weird?
They found the number through the shrew, calls the shrew, mm-hmm. says, hey, we're going to cater lunch over there. What's the address?
Free food, yeah.
He's like, yeah, here's the address. And then even when he gets there, they go, well, how'd they find us? Well, I ordered food, and then they still open the door for him. Still opens the shrew's still an idiot,
yeah.
And still opens the door because it's food.
Bubsy arrives, and a fight breaks out for the helmet. Sid gets the helmet, and he wishes for a corn dog with a bee on it.
Yeah.
Terry gets it and wishes for a big birthday party. Oblivia gets it and wishes to marry Bubsy. Yep,
the wedding.
The buzzard gets it and wishes for everyone to be in his boiling kettle, even the woman that he works for.
Right.
Arnold gets it and wishes for a semi truck.
Another semi.
Because he's so worried about it.
And it crashes through the house where they are.
And then somebody, and then the alley.
Yeah, she gets it.
She gets it and she wants to be like a lifestyle of the rich and famous.
Yeah, she wishes for her own
TV show. Yep.
Yeah. And then Bubby gets it and it's about to explode. It's overloaded or something.
It's going on a neutron overload.
And he wishes for the bad guys to be tied up, which does happen. We get some more live-action clips then.
What's the worst that could happen?
Bubsy puts the helmet back on, and he gets electrocuted. And then we get some big guitar sounds, and like it sounds like some like black ladies singing. Like you know, kind of like kind of hip-hoppy kind of music that they're trying to make Bubsy cool. And that was the end of it right there.
Yeah, it was the end.
It's okay. I'll edit that out. It'll only take me about an hour and a half to get to that part just to edit that out, but I'll get it.
Okay.
Christy.
I refuse to do it. What was the last time you edited?
Last time I edited, I messed up.
Uh-oh. Yeah, you really fucked me on that one. Hey, the show didn't work, and sometimes we ask each other why, but I have a little information here. Viewer reaction wasn't good, and the cartoon failed to entertain. When people rediscovered the cartoon on YouTube years later, it became the subject of ridicule. On Atari Age's Bubsy fan blog, Michael Berlin, the creator of the show, stated that the Accolade developers were cringing while watching the pilot, despite having been involved with the production.
Don't throw it on the floor.
What are you guys talking about?
Gum.
You guys are disgusting people.
Great. Yeah, now your wife's mouth's been on my fingers.
Ayo.
Though he disliked the cartoon, as revealed in an interview, he enjoyed the characters, according to an interview with Sega 16. I thought it was extremely clever. It did a nice job of... You know we can hear all that, right? You know everything you're saying can be heard. You're not being clever or
good.
Boy's getting smart. That means you have to whip his ass. I'm done with that. Scott, you saw the show.
I did.
Your wife was adjacent to the program.
She was there.
But what would you do to improve Bubsy?
Bubsy. You know what? I think it served its purpose. I don't know what you could have done more to make it any worse or better. Maybe a little less being all over the place, but I mean, I think it served its purpose. Probably, I didn't. Now that I realize it was a video game, mm-hmm. I would have to go back and watch said video or play your said video games or whatever to figure out if the show was anything like the video games.
Christy, if this show had been picked up, if someone in the executive level said, we need more Bubsy, where would that season go if it survived? What would happen next, you think?
What kind of adventures would they have?
Oh, gosh, I don't know.
Go to a Furby convention.
Yeah,
put
sure.
a flap in the front or back for whatever reason, doesn't matter.
It's to poop out of.
Mm-hmm. Well, right, hopefully they are nicer to the aardvark or the armadillo.
You want to... If it kept going, just be easier on Arnold?
Yes.
Why don't you think this worked, Blake?
Okay, I didn't really dislike this as much as I read that it was disliked. I was like, this is a cartoon in the 1990s. Mm-hmm. I'm like, it's not supposed to make sense. The storyline, I mean, it was, what's the word I'm looking for? Continuous. I mean, it tied together. Yeah. It tied together. It was a cartoon. I don't know. I didn't think it was that bad.
Okay. So nothing you would... This is a perfect 7 as far as
I wouldn't change very much of it. It was fast. It was fast-paced for sure.
It was.
They got a lot of stuff. Maybe that's what it was. Maybe slow it down just a...
It was pretty fast-paced.
Well, you. What would you change?
Ladies and gentlemen... I would make you not watch the commercial so I'd have to listen to that shit from earlier.
Don't you think it was super fucking weird how there's like a DUI attorney?
Yeah.
And like... And then like, you know,
especially...
I just,
during a kid's...
Right.
Yeah. I like those old commercials. I'm glad you watched it and talked about it. I am.
I feel bad that you guys missed out on it.
So did you not... Did you watch the same version he watched?
Obviously not.
I must have sent different links.
No. The Barbie bubbles
I think what happens was a lot of times he sends me the link and I'll click on the link on my phone because it's in an email and I'll see what the title is. Then when I go to my TV, I have to go open the YouTube and I have to type it all in. I think that's why I said because it doesn't, I can't do that thing that you say where you can go from your phone to your TV. It doesn't work.
Do you have a YouTube account?
No.
Okay, create one. All you have to do is create one. You don't have to pay for it. Just create one. And then you'll have an app on the phone. You have an app on the TV. You got an account there. And you got an app on the phone. It's the same account. And then whatever you watch on the phone, you can see on the TV. You don't have to mirror it. You can say the TV will be like, oh, this is the same account from your phone, right? And you'll be like, yes. And then it'll say, here's the history of what you watched on your phone. And you go to that, and you can watch the same thing.
That's how I watch Bubsy.
Boom. Okay. He's older than you. He should be less inclined technology-wise than you, but he's not. He's more.
Yeah.
I think those glasses frames tell a story.
He does pull them off. Not many guys can pull white glasses off.
Final descent. This is where we say other people have seen the Bubsy pilot, not just us. Rotten Tomatoes, there's no score there. IMDb, this is a aggregate site of people's opinions and ratings. What do you think, Scott? People from around the world rated Bubsy on a scale of 1 to 10 decimal points in play.
A 4.3.
Chrissy?
She wasn't listening to the rules again.
There's no way she was listening.
No, she's checked out.
2.9?
She's checked out for sure. 6.5.
She's the closest. It's 3.2. That's from 234 ratings. You were going to say that? You were not. Get the hell out of here. critic reviews. CartoonWatchingBlogspot.com says, this is from March 14th, 2012. Bubsy, the animated series pilot. If I could describe this pilot in one word, it would be this. Annoying.
What? I don't understand that.
He says, as you could probably tell from how I wrote this post, this was personally very painful to sit through. This wasn't as bad as the episode of Widget the World Watcher that I saw, but it's up there. I've never seen that. He says, the jokes are bad. Most of the cast is bad. The main character wears on your nerves. The plot is annoying. The conflict is non-existent. All around you, you leave this experience with odd, hollow feeling inside.
It's a fucking cartoon, Mr. 48-year-old guy with nothing else to do, you cocksucker YouTube guy.
This is an utter failure at appealing to a hip, attitude-filled demographic.
That's the guy that got fired the first week they started developing.
I'll tell you who this guy is. This is a 15-year-old guy not drinking in high school. That's who this is.
You can tell that guy's by that kid's response, he has not gotten laid yet, and he should have already had that.
All right, viewer reviews. This is from Curiosity Killed Sean. This is from November 24th, 2004. An interesting, if failed, pilot. 6 out of 10 scars. I love Bubsy the Bobcat. He's so cute and funny. His video game was loads of fun, and I thought he had major potential to be a big star, and maybe still. Plus, I loved his T-shirt with the big red exclamation mark.
See, that's
a positive fella.
That's a. Never mind.
This TV pilot, however, was too dated for 1993 and didn't think ahead. The animation, music, and characters were very late 80s in design. The story was too whacked out with no internal logic. And I loved... And while I love Bubsy's trademark "What could possibly go wrong?" line, it's used far too many times
in
this 30-minute pilot.
There's two versions of it. They said, used in your interesting facts. There's two versions of it. The longer version that's like 3 minutes extra. There's 10 times he says it. On the one that I watched, there's 8 times.
Look at him coming heavy with the facts. Listen to those facts.
I did some motherfucking work.
Let's see. Zet, the legendary hero from June 19, 2017, 8 out of 10 scars, a very decent but dated pilot. But the very reason why I ranked it so high is because it's actually still fun to watch, for me at least. I can see the show wasn't supposed to take itself real seriously. The show has all the star voice talents. Also, no one could argue that the villains from the game, the Woolies, were meant to show up later in the series. Also, at least one of the villain designs and 3 of the heroes were used in Bubsy 2, and at least another hero on the box art. I feel like in terms of cartoons, Bubsy could certainly be rebooted into something much better for a wider audience with the new Bubsy reboot game coming out later this year. That might be a real possibility.
What year was that?
That was June 9th, 2017. There was a game, I think, released in 19. There was like a 15 to 20 year hiatus between games. They seriously tried to reboot that property.
Huh, why?
I've never played any of them. I've been aware of them, never played any of them. Anyway, that's enough of that.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to FCF Airport. Local time is 11:11.
Literally every word you say we can hear. Absolutely, without a doubt. What did you just tell him?
Fuck you, Jason.
Why would you tell your son, fuck you, Jason? What an odd thing to say.
That's weird.
Can you imagine coming on someone else's show talking when something, like, you know you're not supposed to and you're trying to hide it, and then telling the host to fuck off? Can you even imagine doing that? What an insane person.
She'd have to have three boobs to do that.
This is my promise to you, Christy. Insane. This is the last time you'll be on the podcast. This is the end of the show where all of us rate the pilot in question. We take the rating scale from the 1990s sitcom affectionately and accurately known as Wings. We look at all the characters from that beloved program and we assign them a number. Number one, that's the worst character and the worst score you're going to get. That's a character goes by the name of Roy Biggins. Number seven, that's the best score and the best character. We call that guy Brian Hackett. Christy, last time you're going to be on the show, without a doubt. We turn to you. How do you rate Bubsy?
A one.
A one.
Wow. I'm sorry.
No apology needed. I don't know. This is subjective. What do you have? You want to elaborate on that at all?
Sorry, Blake. I know you liked it. I thought it was just an annoying cartoon. Mm. It was very annoying.
What cartoons do you watch that are not annoying?
No, that's true. Well, I don't know. I really like Tom and Jerry. They weren't annoying. That was not an annoying cartoon to me.
Where in the world is that little mouse going to be able to hold up a big mallet that he pulled out from behind his back?
Roadrunner.
That's her opinion, though.
White Coyote.
She's out of the house. I guess Biggie lets her have an opinion, I guess. One.
Fine. Scott, you've been our security guard for a long time. Mm-hmm. Close friend of the show from day one. Mm-hmm. You've been with us from day one.
Mm-hmm.
We love you. Do you know that we love you?
Yeah.
You do know that?
Yeah.
Okay. We love you. You guys. We love you very much.
Thank you. I love you guys.
How do you rate Bubsy?
You know what? I didn't.
Shut the fuck up. Shut your fucking mouth.
I
just told Biggie's wife to shut the fuck up.
I gotta go to the bathroom. I'm gonna pee in my pants.
What's out, Dylan? What's out? We had one at the last show. Oh, but now we got this one.
She pissed in your chair, man.
She broke it. She was so mad she broke it.
She left a puddle on that chair. You own that chair now, by the way.
Oh.
We accept Venmo.
Yep, she broke it.
She did. She broke the chair.
She's like, get me the fuck out of here.
That's kind of a career highlight for me. Making someone laugh so much that they break furniture. That counts. That is something.
It counts for something, dude.
Sorry, Scott.
It's fixed.
Before your wife pissed up the place, what were you going to say?
I actually enjoyed it. I thought it was newer than 93, so I didn't even realize it was from 93. It was kind of reminded me of Animaniacs. I think Sonic the Hedgehog had a cartoon.
For sure.
That was successful.
Yeah.
This one wasn't. Very much along those lines. I give it a five.
A five?
Last time I was on here, I absolutely hated the thing I watched, so.
You know what?
Five in it in this one.
I will admit something to you now. I don't think we talked about this last show. With this last season, not only did we finally curate the guests that will be on, I also kind of finally curated the episodes that we'd be watching.
Oh.
When I think about all the times Scott has been on Couch Pilots, the one that really sticks out to me was the time that you came on and we watched Battletoads. Do you remember that?
Oh yeah, it was the other cartoon I watched.
And on Battletoads, there was like a really sexy lady on it. Remember that?
Yeah.
And so I was like, you know what? We had Scott on this cartoon. Let's try to get Scott another cartoon one last time. And that's what we did. So this was kind of picked specifically for you.
Cool. I enjoyed it.
Five. And maybe that's part of the magic of you and your wife working so well is that she gave it a one and you gave it a five. You guys have these difference of opposites attract. Captain Philip Restisher, or do we want to get Dylan's opinion?
Yeah, Dylan watched it.
The boy is here. What's
the scale?
A 1 to 7.
1 to 7, okay.
Into the mic, if possible.
I give it like a four. It was just a mid-90s cartoon. It was okay.
I thought he was going to use like Gen Z like slang and just say right. Mid. I thought he was going to say mid. He's like, yo, bro, this was a totally mad tune.
It was a vibe. It was a vibe,
it did
bro.
Its job, and that's about it.
Yeah.
That's what I
agreed. So we got a 1, a 4, and a 5. Captain Philip, rest assured, we turn towards you. How do you rate Bubsy?
I'm giving it a 5. I mean, it had a storyline. It was, I mean, the artwork was not fucking horrible. People, there was no Band-Aids at the time this was made. We have watched so much shit and so many shitty cartoons. This one was at least entertaining. Was it annoying? Yes, because I'm not 7 fucking years old watching a cartoon. Giving it a 5. Jason, how about you?
I got a quick question before we get to Jason. Was the one you watched, was it digitally remastered?
No, it was not.
See, the one that we watched was digitally remastered and was still shit, but it was digitally remastered.
Right. At least the title said that.
Yeah.
And that's the one that I watched today as well. I did not like this. I always love hand-drawn cartoons. I miss that. Just yesterday at the time of this recording, I went to go see the new Spider-Man Across the Universe or Across the Spider-Verse, and it was fine. It was too long. It's computer animated. It was cool. It looked cool, but I miss hand-drawn cartoons. I grew up watching Ren and Stimpy or the old Warner Brothers cartoons with Bugs Bunny. I like that. I miss those. That doesn't exist anymore.
I grew up watching the hand-drawn Spider-Man.
Yeah, from the 70s, right?
Yeah.
I miss seeing the hand-drawn stuff, so I like it when something like that pops up here with the pilots. But this hand-drawn animation sucks. This story kind of sucks. I think Bubsy, it could have benefited from the SpongeBob approach where you have a half-hour block of programming, but within that block you have 2 separate stories. They're trying to tell this crazy, sporadic story with all these zany characters over 22 minutes. That doesn't work. Give it to me in 10 or 11 minute spurts. That's all these characters can sustain without going nuts. I did not love it. I think I have to give it a 2. I think I kind of hate Bubsy.
Wow.
Ooh, I haven't seen.
Whoa.
5 scores in the room. We got a 1. We got a 2. We got a 4. We got a 5. And you give it a 5 as well? Hand-holding club with Scott?
Yep.
And with that, we'll close the book. Hold his hand. He reached out for you, brother. Hold his hand. With that, we'll close the book on Bubsy, and we'll never mention that show again.
Ever!
But join us next time, won't you please, when we watch the pilot episode of Mystery Incorporated. Here's a little something to wet your whistle. Following the mysterious circumstances of his parents' death, Fred Jones teams up with 3 of his classmates and a dog to seek the truth behind it. Along the way, they must encounter ghosts, vampires, and the occult.
Did you say Scooby-Doo?
I said Mystery Incorporated, but it is a Scooby-Doo show.
Ah!
You can find the entire episode of Mystery Incorporated by subscribing to Couch Pilots on SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Podcast, or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then simply click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to YouTube. Christy! Don't piss in the chair, Christy.
Sorry, too late.
Yes, Mystery Incorporated is like an independent Indiegogo fundraised episode of a proposed series for a Scooby-Doo live-action series.
Ah.
And we have very special guests for that episode and a very special reason why we have those special guests. So tune in next week, won't you please? Go to couchpilotspodcast.com. Blake, we almost have 400 episodes on that website.
Yeah, almost. And you can listen to all of them. It's the only place in the internet that you can listen to every episode.
I listen to everything through Apple Podcasts or iTunes, whatever.
Apple Bottom Podcast with the fur.
I think unless you hit like a special button or pay something, you get like the last 50 episodes of any given podcast. But come on, we got like 400.
Yeah, no,
400.
Come on.
Who else can say that?
I mean, some people,
not many.
What do you think the average number is, Blake? They say there's millions of podcasts. Sure. What do you think the average number of episodes released per podcast is?
I don't think the average podcast gets over 100.
I think you and I are in a rarefied air on multiple fronts.
Yeah.
And I think Scott is too, because
I think it's either
how many karaoke podcasts there were out there.
No, there wasn't many. And there has still, I think there has been a few more since we did our
You've thing. Inspired a generation.
I think I did. At least 3,000 people.
Send us an email at couchpilotspodcast.com. If you send me an email at couchpilotspodcast.com, you will join an elite group of famous people that I personally have interviewed that has sent me an email also to that very same website.
And that's another way that we are a team and teamwork. I mean, what happens is I get a notification that we got an email on the Couch Pots email, right? What do? Go to that email address, Gmail account, open it up and read it?
No, you don't.
No. I text him and say, hey, you got an email. Because I know I didn't do any work to get an email.
Blake and I have like this 50-50 relationship where I do 50% of the work, and then the other 50% is done by him. I'll give you an example. For one, someone sends an email, and he sees that the email comes, and he says, Jason, there's an email. And then from there, I respond to the email. I set up a time with the guy from the email to do an interview. I record the interview. I come up with the questions. I spend the hours investigating how I should invest to talk to the guy. And then I get the file together, and I send it back to Blake, and then he does the other 50%.
It's a perfect marriage.
Go to patreon.com. You can still there's still time to give us some of your money before the show ends. We're not gonna won't say no to your money.
No,
we like it.
We would never say no. We need we don't really need anything for the studio anymore. I'm gonna make this into a dojo. Christy, what do you think? Is this a big, good dojo? Oh,
nice. A dojo.
I don't know if the ceilings are high enough
What are you doing here? This is a one person
dojo. All right,
dojo?
You know what? Since I'm not making it a dojo, it's going to be a sex dungeon. Thanks, Skyline.
That's on you.
Yeah. You're going to come in here next time, and there's going to be a swing from this middle piece.
Scott's so good of a dad that he'll let his son go into his friend's sex dungeon. That's how good of a dad Scott is.
Tell me if you know where this is. Are you ready for the sex girls? The neat, don't neat, don't Midwest girls. Revenge of the Nerds.
Which one? The first one?
The first one.
Hail pie.
Yeah.
Okay, this is the end of the show. Two things I want to do at the end. The first, I do want to give Scott and Christy the opportunity to talk about anything in their lives that they are doing creative and the chance to promote it. I feel like a wise man once said to me, you should do three things in your life. One, to make money. Two, to stay physically active or in shape. And three, have a creative outlet. I think that those are wise words. Sometimes those things overlap with each other. Sometimes they don't, whatever that looks like. But do you guys have something that you're currently doing that's creative for yourselves?
No.
No?
No.
No?
But honestly,
Christy?
No.
Well, do you have any? Is there anything that you're like, boy, I would really like to investigate this, or maybe this is something I could try out? Do you have anything like that in your life? Any aspirations to do that?
No.
No? Okay. You can be
told. How about an OnlyFans? You want to try an OnlyFans out?
Yeah, I would watch you sit on a cake. I was talking to Dylan. I'm sorry.
Hey, if it paid for his college?
Do you remember...
I will pay for your college if I can watch you sit on the cake.
Do you remember back during the Two Girls, One Cup saga?
What about it?
There was also a thing called cakefart.com.
I never... I promise you, I've looked at the worst things on the internet. I've never seen Two Girls, One Cup.
Ooh,
I don't want to see it.
Don't do it.
It's one of the greatest IBWIP bits ever.
It's one of the... sickest that we watched it after a UFC fight in my basement.
Oh, a room of guys together?
It was me.
Oh, Jesus.
It was me, my buddy Jay, my buddy Keith, and Christy. We were down there.
Have you heard of any of these guys before?
No.
There's a reason they're not friends anymore. They all had to watch this thing.
It was bad. And then cake farting was...
I've heard of it. I've never seen that either.
A girl sitting on top of a cake farting on it. It was.
It's got to be like that light that whip topping. It can't be a thick fondant. There's no...
No, it was like a...
there's no give there.
Right. It's not Treskers. It's so definitely
bad.
Kroger's.
So bad.
Ain't nothing wrong with farting.
Christy says,
I don't listen to these. That's the first I've heard of that.
You were there.
That was
you were there.
That was
you,
the cake fart thing.
Yeah, we watched Cake Fart right after Two Girls.
But you were there.
Because I was too busy gagging at the Two Girls, One Cup. I had to go upstairs. I was literally about to throw up.
Yeah, never saw it.
Don't, please.
I have an idea of what it is. And I just think to myself,
why would you
watch that?
Hey,
right, I know.
You're not going to make your life any better watching that.
I agree. Nah. It's like saying, hey, you want to watch Phases of Death?
No,
I don't want to see people eat. We watched Faces of Death when I was kids, and yeah, I could. I'm glad I don't.
There was like Faces of Death,
uh-huh.
Phases of uh-huh. Death, and I think like Traces of Death. I seriously think I saw one of those when I was like 8 or 9, and I said to the guy, "I was like, you're not my friend anymore. Why would
eat
you show
the monkey
me?
Brains?"
Jason, are you
I was gonna say, are you talking about the monkey one?
Yes.
The one, yeah, no.
Okay, can we describe it? We all seen it.
Yes.
Blake, have you seen it?
He hasn't, but it's okay.
Okay, we can describe. We won't watch
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
From what I remember, I seriously think it was probably like 1988, 89, a block away from where I lived, and a friend who was conservatively 5 or 6 years older than me, because I was the youngest kid in my neighborhood, in his living room watching it. I think it was like a table
yes.
with a hole
yes.
in it.
Yes.
And the monkey's head was coming
yes.
out the top.
Yes.
I think they beat it to death yes. with a mallet.
Yes.
Cracked open its head
yes.
and ate its brain.
Yep. That happened.
And I said, I'm a child. Why would you show this to me?
I was
never got an answer.
I think and then, I was only 11 or 12 oh, when I watched God,
there
it.
There was yeah. a fucking website back in the early internet days where you could go and just see the most horrendous fucking shit.
Was it rotten.com?
It was rotten.com. Oh my God.
Yeah, I remember that now.
Her dad introduced me to rotten.com.
When you are young, there is like, oh, I should see some really wild shit. But then when you get older, you're like, should not have seen
yes,
that.
Yes.
Like,
we can imagine the worst things. I don't need confirmation don't that they have it. Happened and exist.
Her, I mean, before me and her ever met, her uncle got killed by a train.
Okay.
And that was one of the one that you stumbled upon on rotten.com was people that got hit by a train.
Not specifically him, but something in that same scenario.
Yeah.
Though. Yeah. I don't ever want to, there's no reason to see that. It's like when people say video games cause, mass shootings. No, but everything that you eat or see or smoke, it does affect you. Anything you take in will affect you,
right.
Including being 8 years old and watching a monkey brain being devoured.
Mm-hmm.
Not great. And that's usually how we like to end all the shows. thank you both for being here. That's the second thing I want to say. First was about the creative endeavor. The second is thank you both for being a part of the show.
Absolutely.
For as many years as you have. I think I said the last show, Blake, but this show, doing this program with you for the past 8 years has been, it's literally been a big chunk of my life, and it does mean a lot to me. And the people that we have on this last season, it is very meaningful to me to have them here. So while this is only your second episode, obviously you mean the world to Scott, and because you do, Christy, you mean a lot to us too. So thank you for being here. You want to say anything, Blake?
Oh,
this is Jason.
Are you make her cry. She gets emotional.
Blake, is there anything you want to say?
I'm afraid to. Biggie, I love the shit out of you. We grew up together,
uh-huh.
And then one day we're at a vape shop and we see each other.
Yeah,
and it was like we just hit the ground running. It was awesome. It's awesome having you on. You are dedicated to this. I mean, when you were doing it and when you were on, you put effort. We have a lot of people come in here just
a tattoo to prove
it. I got people come in here and just get on their fucking Snapchat. Oh yeah, that to be honest with you, you're the only other person besides me that has an IBWIP
that's
tattoo.
That's true.
I did not remember.
Let's see that. You kind of lifted up. You do literally have a tattoo of the old show. Yes, you have an IBWI tattoo on your right.
From the poster.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. That's true.
You are a great friend and you are awesome on the show. I really and Karaoke Biggie Hickety Tuesday was probably the funnest thing I ever experienced, and I think that is a highlight of my podcasting is being involved and seeing other people's magic happen, not being directly affected, involved in it. Mm-hmm. Like I was just watching that. I was just sitting here in front of this thing, just making sure that every time he screamed into the microphone, I turn it down, and then he back away from it, and I turn it back up. But you don't give yourself enough credit. You did an amazing job. We miss the show. When you're on the show, we have an amazing job. Christy, to put up with him for 28 years, it's pretty fucking awesome. Dylon, pretty badass. Kind of shy boy, but don't rub his back in public in front of people anymore. Will you please not do that? Because I saw you doing that, and I thought to myself, this is why he's a soft boy. Drink that beer, chuck that sumbitch, tell your mom to get your hands off of it. Thank you guys for being on the show. We love you guys. Seriously.
Thank you.
Scott's one of the guys to where if you ask him, the answer is always yes. Will you come on the show? Will you do this? The answer is always yes. Yeah. Scott's a tough guy sometimes to nail down, but he will always make time for this.
For sure.
That is true. So we thank you for that. Anything you guys want to say as we're winding down here?
Anything?
No.
I know I got at least one more of these to go.
All right, we're not going to talk about that. That's
exactly.
That was a secret you just gave up.
Yeah.
So.
No. I'd say.
No, that's right. We're not going to talk. That's not right. Out there yet. But yes, thank you.
Yeah.
I
appreciate everything that you guys have done to keep me creative. If it wasn't for the fact I had somewhere to come every Sunday, not a Sunday afternoon for three years, you know, it was the funnest thing I ever did. Besides my marriage and
good save, buddy.
My marriage and my son, it's the most dedicated, most thing I was ever dedicated to.
I totally understand that. Yeah, that was the karaoke was a good time. Blake, this is your part of the show where you have something to say at the end. We block a little time at the end of every episode for you to speak your piece, as it were.
You have put up with a lot of shit in the past 8 years. For me to expect someone to come to my house every other Monday for 8 years, never go to your house, but have you drive all the way here, have you do 1,000 more times work than I do, and be okay with it. I'm sure there's part of you that would be like, what a fucking lazy ass. But you just accept me for me, and you want to make this happen, and that is a special person. Because if I had to come to your house every other Monday for 8 years and do all this work, I don't know if I would do it. Not because I would out Fred, but you're that kind of person that you've pushed me to keep this going, and you've pushed me to make it good still, and you've definitely done more for it than me. And maybe I'm an asshole for I definitely don't expect it. Maybe I'm an asshole to take it for granted. So I appreciate that.
I don't know if you take it for granted, but I think a lot of times people say, "You remember the good times? You remember way back when the good times?" I'm not that guy. These are the good times.
100%.
This pilot may have been rough, but it's always a smooth flight here on Couch Pilots. Thanks, everyone, and we'll see you next time.
See everybody later on.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.